Introducing the reigning, defending, inside fighting host, Bobby Sid Clark.
All right, so we got Dustin the Diamond Poirier here, former UFC lightweight champ, 27-fight UFC veteran, 29 if you include the WEC bouts as well. Dustin, welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me on, man.
You're just over a month removed now from your exciting fight with Charles Oliveira. I know you weren't too happy about the outcome, obviously, or your performance there. Have you had a chance to break down the fight yet and maybe contemplate what you might do differently in a rematch?
Yeah, of course. You know, hindsight's always 20/20 with these things. Looking back at it, I would have done a lot of things differently. But to answer the question, I have.
And is there any specifics or keeping that close to the guard?
No, I think I should have did a better job of my footwork, not allow myself to be clinched up as easy and kind of, you know, smothered my striking output by getting that close, allowing him to walk forward and just get into that clinch range. Obviously second round, I wouldn't have given up the round like that. I would have maybe tried to use my jiu-jitsu to sweep or submit him. There's a bunch of stuff.
Yeah, no, I mean, you had him hurt at least a couple times in the first round, it looked like. Is that something that gives you any, you know, peace of mind at all, or just kind of encouragement if you guys were to get in there again, or is that just make it a little bit more bittersweet?
Yeah, it's cool, but like, I lost the fight, you know. I hit him with some good shots. He was durable, more durable than I thought he was going to be. You know, he stayed in the fight as he did in this fight before that with Chandler. He got hit with some big shots, went down, almost got finished and came back to win. Showed the world once again that he has what it takes to be a world champion. And that's it, man. He's the champ.
Yeah, no, and I did watch your interview with Ariel that happened, you know, right after the fight, as he does there. And I know you said at the time you were just drinking beer and eating cookies. Have you gotten back into the gym since then?
Yeah, I've been training. I actually just got back last night. I was in Arizona for a week with my buddy, just fought in Bellator. And he got another win there, another finish. So I'm always around the sport. If I'm not preparing for a fight, I have a roster, a stable of young fighters here in Louisiana. And I also have my family, you know, my team back in South Florida, American Top Team. There's always big fights people are getting ready for. So anywhere I can help out, I try to do that just to stay around the sport and stay on the mats. But I trained today with some younger guys. One of my buddies is making his UFC debut in 2 months here from Louisiana. So I'm excited for him, trying to help him out, give him insights, anything I just the experience I've had over the years. So I'm always around the sport. I'm never completely out.
Yeah. And I think you can give yourself a few days off after any fight, especially a title fight like that. Right. So that makes sense.
Yeah. Yeah. It's one step at a time. So one less cookie, one less beer a day. We're on the right track.
And I know you had also said, I mean, one of the things that, people bring up sometimes with it being such an American bred sport is the amount of weight that people have to cut. And you had alluded to, you know, obviously being at 155, you got to fight at a calorie deficit, you know, or train at a calorie deficit consistently. Right. Are you still feeling that way that you want to fight at 170 or maybe try that out instead of 155 for your next bout?
You know, I can still make 155. I'm still the same weight I usually am outside of training camp. But just for me to go back down to 55, it has to be a big opportunity or it has to mean something. You know, I don't want to be like in a rat race, just fighting to fight. If I'm going to make that cut, I need to be setting myself up for a world title shot or in a title fight. Otherwise, I'll just go to 170 and have fun fights that are big and exciting and motivate me.
You definitely earned your keep and just 33 years of age and happy birthday. I know it's just about a week and a half ago, right? So
thanks,
happy
man.
Birthday. Happy belated birthday.
I appreciate it.
You came out of that fight, I know you said, with no injury. So it was more of a mental thing. You were upset about your performance, just didn't feel dialed in there. Did you have any, you know, expectations of when you wanted to fight again, or it's really about, you know, the fight and having something exciting?
That's it. That's what it's about. You know, I don't have a date or a month that I'm looking at. It's just when I get the call with a fight that makes me feel that wanting to fight, wanting to beat this guy, it has to be something personal to me. I don't want it to just be a sport thing. I think that's kind of a rut I got into in this last fight. It just felt like an opportunity. Yeah, I'm trying to be the world champion, but it didn't feel, for some reason, it has to be more than that. You know, I don't want it to just be another fight.
Then maybe for the title fight, you were more motivated about the belt than necessarily fighting Charleston?
Yeah, 100%. No doubt about it. I not that I didn't respect him, you know, I definitely respected the kid, and he's had a great career. I've been a fan for a long time, but yeah, it was more about the belt in that one. It had nothing to do with Charles.
And now, I mean, we've got Chandler and Ferguson's in the works. Justin and Charles obviously are looking like they're going to do that title fight. So in terms of exciting fights, you know, and potentially even foray or entrance into the 170-pound fight, Nate Diaz from the fans seems to be the only option right now. Is that kind of what your thoughts are?
That is. And that's the direction I believe the UFC wants to move. I think they're just trying to get it all worked out and figured out. That's a name and a guy who I've been watching fight for a long time. And that's exciting to me, you know?
Yeah, I think that's been widely publicized. I think he's got one fight left on his contract right now. And I think that's kind of the issue, at least on the insiders.
Yeah, that's what's holding this thing up. Yeah, I can't do anything about his contractual obligations or what the UFC is working out with. And that has nothing to do with me. You know, I can't really speak on that.
No, absolutely. Now, I wanted to get in also, Jake Paul obviously just released a song called Explicit Dana White. Obviously, you've done very well for yourself in recent years, but I wanted to get your thoughts on the fighter pay talk now that it's been a big issue. I mean, you got the heavyweight champion Francis having issues and, you know, the media picking up. Do you think this is a good thing to talk about or what are your thoughts on fighter pay right now?
You know, I think that the more people who do speak up and the more it's in the media and the press, it draws more attention to it. And that's great. You know, I think the pay rates will continue to increase year after year. I do think we should be paid more for sure. You know, we sign these contracts. You're not forced into fighting. So and it's an individual thing. Like for me, I'm just trying to navigate and do the best deals I can from here on. So it is what it is, you know?
So safe to say you're happy with your contract now. And again, that seems to be something with the top tier fighters now. Once you're there long enough, you can get it. It just seems it's tough, I think, particularly for the entry level fighters who are coming in and don't have that experience behind them. Right. So I think that's a big.
Yeah. Risk. I mean, entry level pay was even less when I first came to the UFC 11 years ago, but it might be 12 and 12 now, 12,000 to show. I think 12,000 to win might be the base starting point in the UFC. I think I'm not 100% on this, but. You know, you go out there and win a fight or worst case scenario, you go out there and lose, you know, and you get $12,000 and then you got to pay medicals in preparation for the fight. And, you know, they UFC does a good job of taking care of us. If something happens in the fight, everything's taken care of. You know, they give us the best, put us in touch with the best doctors, get us fixed, get us treated, get us back, you know, on the road to recovery to be able to compete. They do a good job with that stuff. But if you're making $12,000 and you lose and you all your medicals to get cleared for the fight, all the athletic commission stuff and all that, that's out of pocket before the fights. And then taxes, then your gym fees and stuff like that. You know, it's not a lot of money left on the table after everyone's paid.
No, you're absolutely right. I think one of the things I was talking about this a little while ago that, you know, I think it's difficult for the entry level fighters is not, you know, they're on a rookie contract, but like you said, if they lose, I understand back in the day when they had the win bonus, because, you know, a lot of people were still kind of part-time fighters. If you're going 10, 15, maybe even 20 years ago, and they're coming in just for that paycheck. Now, anybody who enters the UFC, you know, they're an athlete, they're a professional athlete and they've been doing it for a while. So yeah, I think there's, yeah, obviously things they could do with the entry level to maybe take that away. But I know guys like you guys have different contracts. You don't have just a fight and a win bonus. Again, that's more on the entry level side.
Yeah. Yeah. I get, just going through so many contracts, fighting the amount of high level fighters I've fought, winning the fights that I've won. I'm in a different position.
Yeah, absolutely. Now, I know I wanted to clear the air a bit because I completely got your side when you came back on this, but I know Charles came out with a misunderstanding of the donation. And I know you've, you know, spoken about it and you were looking for a direction of funds or charity to donate to, which of course makes sense. Were you able to resolve that or get that worked out?
So I ended up getting in touch with Charles and his team. And we had some back and forth talk about where the money was going to go. The right after the fight, he had sent me his personal banking information. I was like, you know, I have a nonprofit. I can't directly deposit $20,000 from my nonprofit into your banking account. I think, and probably I'm sure the translation, you know, he's probably using a translator to text me back. That's the way we're speaking through what on WhatsApp. He's probably using a translator. So some of the stuff probably got mixed up. Maybe when I asked him about where the money would go and he sent me his personal info, But then now we got it resolved. So he's looking for a charity, and we're also speaking to the UFC, Brazilian department of the UFC, and we're working with them. So 20,000 is going to somewhere.
Yeah, no, I think it was good to clear the air though too. I wanted to say that because when I read his interview back, I was like, well, this sounds like a misunderstanding. Obviously, you're going to need a place to put it, and then you know, people reading Charles might not understand that. So it's good that you know, you put that out there. So I wanted to just bring it up again.
Yeah, I appreciate it. And he went back on Twitter and said, hey, I'm speaking to Dustin. And we're in contact. It took me like a week to get in touch with him after the fight. I was actually talking to his coach at first. Then I got his contact information.
Okay, well, that's great to hear. Let's get back into the fight game now. So, you know, we got Conor McGregor. He's obviously looking to come back. We know he wanted the title fight, but it looks like Justin he has that one now. Is that a match that you would be excited for? And would you prefer that bout to take place at 170? But yeah, first, is that, you know, going into a fourth match there, is that something that excites you?
I mean, besides money, what would I be doing it for? I beat the guy two times in a row last year, you know, knocked him out, 10-8ed him in the first round of our last fight. It's just like, we'll see. I don't know. We're not currently talking about it with the UFC, but I'm sure it's never out of the question. You know, I'm sure he wants to fight me. No doubt about it. He wants to get those wins back. We'll see what happens when they call, but they haven't said a word about it yet. I'm not sure if they have a plan for him or what they're going to do when he gets back or gets healthy, but they haven't told me anything.
That's what I was saying. I know you said before, you're like, one of your thoughts were like, you know, I'm not sure if I'm ever going to get a title fight again, but you know, there's a couple clear ways that we see that happening. First off, if Justin is able to beat Gaethje, obviously, I mean, that's a clear line to the title right there as well too, if that were to happen. And again, if same thing with Conor as well too, if he were able to do that, then obviously there's a rematch there as well too. And a lot of the other guys, like I said, that are right there, Chandler would be a very exciting fight if he made his way back there. But I do see a lot of lines after you've had time to process it. Is that kind of your thoughts as well too? Because I know you wouldn't really want to make that cut unless it was something exciting.
Yeah, I know Justin's always talked about getting that rematch back, getting that loss back. That's an exciting fight for me because I know the dangers of it. I know how dangerous this guy is and what he brings into the fights. I think the fans would want to see it as well. So that's another rematch that could happen down the road, I do believe. But it's just like, if he does go out there and win the belt, does the UFC give me another title shot? You know, I'd have to fight someone before, you know, fighting Justin again if we did a rematch at 155. I would assume. So I don't know, man. I wish I had better answers for like the way the weight division's going. Chandler's tied up. He's fighting Tony Ferguson, I believe I read. So yeah. We'll see what happens as the division keeps unfolding, as these fights happen that are booked right now. Anything's possible. Nothing surprises me in the sport, I'll tell you that. I guess anything's possible.
Yeah, no, for sure. It's you never know. It keeps you on your toes. And there's a lot of these, you know, short notice fights. I've been noticing since the pandemic, they've really done a lot of short notice fights. Is there a reason for that? Any particular reason you know of, or it's just scheduling?
I haven't heard anything about people getting more short notice fights or anything like that. I haven't heard anything.
Okay, yeah, sorry. I just, you know, it seemed to be a lot of, I mean, you and Nate Diaz, that was proposed in 1 month. I know Taito Ivas, I believe, just got a fight with
her. I think, I believe the Nate Diaz thing, that with me and him, we're going to be short notice in January because something happened on the card, or maybe Ngannou's knee was giving him problems. Something had happened that I don't know the full details about that even started them talking about the fight being added to that card.
Gotcha. So safe to say, if you fought Conor, it'd be really for the money right now. You don't have anything to prove to yourself. And then with Nate, that's something that you're actually excited about. Either fight, though, I guess, or any fight that might come from there, you're looking at a 170-pound matchup?
Yeah. Yeah.
And what are you walking around at right now?
This morning, I was 181. Yesterday afternoon, I was like 182-ish. So I'd say 180.
And do you think that would you try to bulk at all, or just, you know, keep your body the way it is going into a 170-pound fight?
No, I would keep lifting weights. I've already started a pretty good lifting routine now with my coach, Phil Daru. He's been emailing me everything. I'm lifting like three times a week, but I would maybe put on a couple pounds just so I'm not so light, because where I'm at right now, if I get in fight shape, I'm probably going to be like 175, you know, 175 pounds. And make the weight and rehydrate, I'm going to be 175, 177 on fight night, you know, and then these guys are going to be 190 something.
Yeah.
You know, I don't want to be undersized in there, but I would keep it around there, you know, keep it on mid to high 70s and make the cut from there just so I'm not too small.
Makes sense. Yeah, no, and I really do like, I mean, they've done it a few times, but especially with the some of the, you know, big names like yourself, you know, if both agree to fight at 170, when we're 55ers, hey, let's just not cut a lot of weight and fight at 170. So I think that's
right.
You know, shy of adding more weight classes.
Yeah, I know they don't like to do it. If guys are contenders or about to fight for the belt, they want the fight to be at the weight class. That way it has title implications, you know. But me and Nate Diaz is that if we go to 170 and do it, it doesn't really have title implications at 155 or 170, I don't think. You know, we'll see.
But it's a fight the world wants to see too, right? So it's two guys. Like you said, been around forever. I mean, you've been around almost as long in WEC, right? So that's definitely, you know, let's hope that one can get worked out because that'll be a really exciting match for everybody.
Yeah, I have a feeling it's going to come together.
And yeah. Now, have you had a chance to break down or even just mentally thought about Justin and Charles and how you think that fight will go?
You know, Charles has more ways to win. Justin has to knock him out. I think Charles can knock Justin out. Charles can submit him. Charles can win a decision. He has more ways to win. Not saying that Gaethje won't knock him out. You know, Charles is a guy who gets hit a lot. In his last two fights, he's touched the canvas in both fights. And Gaethje's a guy that if he gets you hurt, he usually puts you away. And he has big power. So if you're able to get touched, you know, you might not recover. It's an interesting fight, but Charles has more ways to win.
And is that obviously, would you prefer obviously Justin wins? Because it gives you a little bit more, you know, obviously that's a fight people are going to want to see again if he wins that, right? Because you finished and you're pretty dominant in that. So
I'm just watching as a fan, you know, now I'm not rooting for anybody or pulling for anybody. Whatever's going to happen will happen, man. It's not out of my control with that stuff, but I just hope it'll be a great fight.
Yeah, no, it makes sense. Now, before the last few questions, I wanted to bring up the fact that, you know, you never graduated grade 9. I say this because you're an extremely motivating person and, you know, where you've been through and just, you know, trials, tribulations and being able to overcome obstacles like anybody who reaches the top of anything is. And I wanted to know, how would you apply that or speak to people about what you've learned in fighting and that you can apply to being successful to anything in life?
You know, fighting has taught me how important being open-minded on the mats and in conversation and picking people's brains about fighting. You know, I've learned that I can just remain a student. To remain a student in that mindset, I can learn something from everyone I meet in the gym. You know, I can learn something from guys who have way less experience than me. We all do things differently. We all, even the same technique, we set them up differently. There's very intricate details that everybody does different. So I'm always trying to learn and talk and watch when I'm on the mats. But fighting has taught me self-belief and consistency, man, how important being consistent is. On the days that I don't feel like going in, I go in. You know, it's taught me discipline. You know, that's what discipline is, going when you don't want to. And remaining a student, I think that's beneficial for any walk of life, not just combat sports. That's any kind of business, you know, believing in yourself, taking the leaps of faith when you need to, and showing up every day ready to get your hands dirty. You know, you have to have that mindset, blue collar.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. And now I know we'll go over to the Fight Foundation. I mean, you're always working on something. I know your last goal was to, I believe, get 300,000 meals for, I forget what the charity's name was for, but what's going on in Fight Foundation right now?
Yeah, the Good Fight Foundation is still rolling, still going strong, man. We just finished up the second Harvest Food Bank goal that we had set up for this last fight. And we had a lot of holiday things going on as well. Toys for Tots and giving back to some local places here that house women and children. Around the holiday season, we gave back there. Beat the Streets Wrestling Club, you know, they had a fundraiser they launched that we got partnered up with. Just keeping it growing, man. We really want to set something big up for the first quarter of this year. We haven't locked any goal down yet for this first quarter, but we're going to do something soon. You know, we're going to announce something soon.
Nice, man. That's cool. I also wanted to, sorry, to go back on the last question. I know you just said you were helping, you know, some of the younger guys train for fights. Is this a train? I mean, you're so young because you've done so many fights, but you're still only 33, right? So, but eventually when you decide to transition, do you feel like you'll be on the coaching side of things? Is that, you see yourself being a part of mixed martial arts your whole life?
I'm never going to be far away from the sport. I'm not sure if I'm going to be a coach or but I'm always going to be on the mats training, trying to help guys out. I do enjoy coaching guys. Like this last weekend in Bellator, my buddy went out there, fought, had a great performance and won. I love helping him out in camp. I like to see the journey that these guys go on because I've walked that walk so many times. I feel like I have a lot of insight into the mindset of preparing for this and for going out there and putting it all on the line in front of the world. It's something I like to do. The thing that I'm not so in love with is like teaching people from scratch, like a blank slate, somebody who's never threw a punch in their life. I don't really like, you know, showing them the ropes, but when guys have experience and have been fighting, I love to help out there. Like you said, man, I'm a young veteran and I don't know what the next step would be after it's all done.
Yeah, it's funny you say that. I did some personal training a long time ago, and one of my biggest things was there because it was just for a generic gym. Was like, I don't mind training like young athletes who are in it to win it, but you know, it's the people coming in on day one who, you know, don't want to put the work in, or like you said, not technical, especially at your level, right? You would be a coach for not even a coach, but just wanting to mentor people who want to get to your level, who see what you do and want to achieve it the same. So that makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, I enjoy working with those guys.
Yeah, makes sense. The Diamond Hot Sauce, how is that going for you?
I got a bottle right over here. It's going great, man. We're crushing it. But that's it, man. You put out a good product and it speaks for itself. You know, I try to get a bottle in everyone's hand that I can. It's like a edible business card. Give it to them, let them pass it around, let them show their friends, let their friends taste it. Yeah, every fight trip, I usually bring a bunch with me.
That's great, man. And what of all foods do you enjoy putting the hot sauce on? What is your number one choice for food?
Shoot, it's great on a lot of stuff, but breakfast, man. Eggs. Oh, yeah, eggs.
Yeah. Okay, that makes sense. So with that, are you doing what's the approach there? Obviously, that's great bringing it in there. You guys are working distribution. Is it a lot locally or any new plans for that this year?
Yeah, we're trying to grow just the sales side. I think last year we were maybe 30% wholesale, 70% direct to consumer. So 70% of our sales were online. And I think moving forward, the strategy is to start leveling that out a little bit. If we can get this year, maybe 40-60, next year, 50-50, just so it can be in stores, on shelves, and sustainable for a while. But I just need to get it into people's hands so they can taste it.
No, that's so cool, man. Like, and I like that you have the opportunity to be doing these things now. And I think that's another thing. Like you said, you're a young veteran right now, 33, and now you're starting businesses as well too. And it's tough, I think, for a lot of people to find that transition. And you know, you've been fortunate enough, I guess, to understand that as well too. Is there other things, other businesses that you're getting into or in the future hope to get into?
Yeah, I just teamed up with some guys, a great group of guys, and we're launching a bourbon. It's just starting the initial rollout of it. You know, they've been working on it for a while. I jumped in probably a year ago, and we're finally coming to market with it. So we're going to start distribution for that and rolling it out state by state. I like whiskey. So I'm learning a lot of stuff, even from the hot sauce side of things. Now that we've been selling for 13, 14 months with the sauce, I've learned a lot of stuff that I can take into this next business venture I go into with the bourbon. And I'm learning, man, just like I said about fighting, this is exactly what we just talked about, being a student and asking questions and listening and reading and trying to be on the cusp of whatever's going on in the industries that I'm in. That's what I do, just remain a student. And I take that mindset with me to everything.
100%. And that's why, like, you know, top athletes and entertainers, they always say that if you can reach the top of that sport, you can definitely master business, I find. Because, you know, in the big leagues, you swing 2 for 10, you're not making the big leagues. You go 3 for 10 and you're in the all-star game, you know, and business is one of those things where you can keep swinging, keep learning. There's no time clock there, so you can get better and better. But I think that's so cool that, you know, you're taking that approach and I can see, like, from that, you're going to take that same mindset over to business and you're going to dominate that as well too. So that's pretty cool, man.
I appreciate it, man. I just try to tie myself to things that I'm interested in or things that I really like. Like, I love cooking. I love hot sauce. So it made sense. And I was passionate about it. I like whiskey. I like bourbon. I have a big bourbon collection upstairs in my bar. And whenever I tried this product that these guys have put together, it just felt like a good fit. And it was something that I enjoy and something that I do. And it's what I want to be around, what I want to be part of. So if I can continue my business strategies like that, things that I use on a daily basis, things that I like to do, if the passion's there, then it makes sense.
That's a good thing. Is I was going to ask, do you like bourbon? Because I think that's going to be a key factor there, right? So that's definitely going to help help you sell it as well too, and be motivated by it. What I haven't heard the name of that yet. What's the name of the bourbon?
It's Rare Stash Bourbon.
Rare Stash Bourbon. I think I did hear that. Yeah, that's awesome. And you said you're rolling out in.
state. We're going state by state. I think we're going to roll out Louisiana first here.
Okay.
Then I think we have Nevada, Florida, or maybe Florida's before Nevada. We have a rollout plan set up, but right now we're on reservebar.com. And I think we're in 30 states. Maybe you can get it shipped directly to your door. But we just got a big distribution deal with a huge company, and we're about to start rolling out state by state in the wholesale.
Oh, that's incredible, man. That's incredible. Okay, we'll get back then. So now back to the hot sauce a bit. What cheat meals, or what's a favorite meal after a fight? Or I don't know if you splurge that much after the weigh-ins, but what's your favorite meal to have when you're not cutting weight? And add the hot sauce, please.
If you're talking hot sauce meals or cheat meals, if I'm in Louisiana and it's a hot sauce meal, it's going to be like gumbo or jambalaya, something, you know, Cajun out here in Louisiana. But if I'm like in training camp and I can get a cheat day or something, it's going to be pizza or a burger, something simple, you know. I put the sauce on pizza too.
Yeah, I was going to say that's a good fit right there, right? So awesome.
When I'm in training camp, dude, and I get a cheat day, it's all about carbs and salt and stuff for me, dude. That's what I crave when I'm out there cutting weight.
So so you take one day for a cheat meal every single week, and you kind of go, and is it a cheat meal or a cheat day? Because people get those confused. And I do like to get into nutrition a little bit with the fighters, because you guys have obviously mastered it for the most part, right? So.
Yeah, it's a cheat meal. It's a one meal. And it's usually right after a workout, and it's not every week. It's depending how my weight is fluctuating. If I'm on schedule, above, you know, ahead of schedule, then I can have one day. One meal. I don't even like to use the word cheat. It's not a cheat meal. It's an earned meal.
Yeah, I like that. I remember Sean Shirk used to say, he's like, I don't have cheat meals. What are the, you know, like,
it was
really fun. But no, that's one of the things people don't see either, is how disciplined you guys have to be with your diet, right? Do you mind taking me through a normal breakfast, lunch, and dinner for you when during a training camp?
I can give you like an average peep into it, but it just depends where I'm at in training camp. Because obviously at the end of training camp, calories are probably they're at the lowest. So it's, but I would say middle training camp, if I'm 3 weeks into camp, I might have oatmeal, two eggs, maybe some almonds or some kind of fat, some peanut butter or something with that. Go to the gym, come back, either have a snack or have lunch. It'd probably be yogurt and berries, or yogurt and a half a banana. If it's a snack, lunch, probably a 4 ounce piece of salmon with broccoli or with asparagus and some fats, half an avocado. And it's kind of like that, you know, those meals are interchangeable, but pretty much the same thing throughout camp. It's going to be a very small piece of lean protein, some kind of fat, and some kind of greens.
Now, are you, do you take any shakes with that as well too? Do you care about, you know, loading up protein? I know a lot of people are obviously big, especially when cutting down weight to retain size. Is that a big important to you, or you found that your body's good without it?
I do it sometimes. It's not like something that I'm religiously doing, but I'll mix some blueberries and some vanilla protein after a training session here and there. I actually have dietitians who help me out in camp. So whatever they say, if they tell me a protein shake after wrestling, I'll do a protein shake. I just do what I'm told when it comes to the nutrition part.
Well, I mean, it sounds very healthy regardless what you just said. So it's your kidneys, I'm sure, thank you for it. So that's
good. Yeah, I feel good. I feel healthy.
Yeah, you look healthy, so it's good. But
thanks, man.
Dustin, man, really appreciate you coming on. Is there any last words you have for opponents or sponsors or anything you want to say?
Get a deal done, Nate. Let's do this. Let's throw some hands. But when it comes to sponsors, dude, I'm so grateful and thankful for Everlast, Vanquish, Samsung, Celsius. I have a bunch of great brands that have my back, and I'm thankful because all of these things are organic partnerships. That Robert Graham, you know, all the colorful shirts I wear. People always ask me what you know on Twitter and stuff. Where do you shop at for your shirts? All those colorful shirts. Robert Graham. And like I said, the organic part is I was wearing these shirts before I got the deals. A lot of these deals that I have with Celsius, with Samsung, it's all because I was using products before. So it's a good fit.
Yeah, that's really cool, man. And listen, I speak for everyone. I'm sure we hope that that fight with you and Nate gets booked at 170. And man, I look forward to continuing to watch you and coming to your next fights. And yeah, man, thank you so much for coming on the show.
My pleasure, man. Thank you for having me.
Awesome, brother. Have a great day.
All right. You too, man.